Hi, and welcome to my talk on the template method pattern. This is Abram Hindle, and this is part of the Design Patterns lectures for Compute 301. So, we're talking about the template method pattern. The template method pattern basically is a generalization pattern. We try to look for commonalities between two processes, and then we combine them with a general part and specific parts. So consider these two recipes, a coffee recipe and a tea recipe. Our coffee recipe is boil some water, brew coffee in the water, pour coffee in a cup, and add milk and sugar. A tea recipe would be boil some water, steep the tea in the water, remove the tea from the water, and pour a cup of tea and add sugar, milk, and lemon. What parts are common? Well, boiling water is common. Steeping or brewing in water is common. Pouring or removing things. Well, removing tea from water is different than the coffee recipe, but pouring into a cup is similar, as well as adding various condiments. So we could actually generalize this as maybe boil water, insert brew or steep, and then do an extra step, and then pour into cup and add condiments. So we can make a public class. We could have our public class recipe be represented by this: a make recipe which boils waters, brews coffee grinds, pours in cups, and adds sugar and milk. So we have all these methods here. Because we don't have a coffee machine to experiment, we're just going to print to the console. Tea is pretty well similar: boil water, steep tea, remove tea, pour in cup, add sugar, milk, lemon. We do pretty well the same stuff. We could generalize. So what we could do is we could make a hot caffeinated beverage class that is a template method class, and it contains the make recipe, the boil water, and pouring cup. So the coffee could have make recipe, brew coffee grinds, add sugar and milk, while the tea could have steep tea, remove tea, add sugar and milk and lemon. So we could generalize in that way. And they could both inherit the general recipe as well as the boiling water and pouring in cup methods from the hot caffeine beverage. So the general recipe, they have similar algorithms. We're noticing this. We want to generalize it. Boil some water. Use water to extract coffee or tea. Pour the beverage into a cup, add appropriate condiments. So if we compare them, they look pretty similar. So in our template method, what we can do is our make recipe can boil water, it can brew, it can pour in cup, and it can add condiments. What we want, though, is we want brew and add condiments to be specialized. We want anyone who inherits this class to specialize brew and add condiments. We're indicating to readers and clients of this class that we want them to implement brew and condiments because we have marked them abstract. So they cannot build a class that inherits hot caffeine beverage that isn't abstract without implementing brew or add condiments. So our code actually gets simplified. Our coffee code changes into brewing the coffee for brew, and add condiments turns into adding milk and sugar. Our brew for tea includes the steeping the tea and the removing the tea, and our condiments include adding lemon. So we now have a general algorithm, and then we have specialized implementations that extend the general algorithm through points of extension. And this is basically called the template method. The template method allows you to insert things into them. So we've got our abstract superclass, hot caffeine beverage. We tell it to make a recipe. We've got brew. We've got add condiments. We boil water, pour in cup. Both coffee and tea have brew and add condiments. So before, coffee and tea had the algorithm. We duplicated code in coffee and tea. after coffee beverage had the algorithm, and instead of duplicating coffee in coffee and tea, we reduced duplication and enhanced reuse by relying on the hot caffeine beverage. Changing the algorithm in the original case required opening the subclasses and making multiple changes. This algorithm is found in one place, so changes to it are localized. If the algorithm changes, we change it in one spot. If there's a bug in the algorithm, we only change it in one spot. So, why template method? So before, our original structure required a lot more work to add a new subclass. Oftentimes, we'd have to provide the entire algorithm again. After, our new structure provided a framework where we could add new subclasses, and we could just provide distinct parts of the algorithm. The intent of the design of the template method pattern is to define a skeleton of an algorithm in a method, deferring some of the steps to the subclasses. That is, the algorithm is kept higher up in the inheritance hierarchy, and then the subclasses do the specializations necessary to make this algorithm fit one particular context. The UML for a template method structure looks like this. We'll have an abstract class and has a template method, and it calls primitive operation 1, primitive operation 2. These primitive operations should be abstract if they're meant to be implemented. A concrete class that wants to take advantage of this template method will implement each of these primitive operations. The template method usually will call the primitive operations, and many times a good places to put these primitive operations are before and after a lot of work in the before and after some computation. The consequence of this pattern is that control is inverted. The superclass ends up calling subclass methods. Furthermore, it's the Hollywood principle, it's the framework principle, it's the bad Soviet Russia joke. Don't call us, we'll call you. Template methods are basically like hooks. The primitive operations in a template method are hooks that let you do that let you specialize behavior. Oftentimes, you can have the default template method work, and you can have the hooks do nothing by default, allowing for subclasses to override. So you might have a template method where you force overriding, but then you have a default operation that could be overridden, but does nothing by default. So if you had header footer, you could have an empty implementation of header, empty implementation of footer, but you would allow the developers to provide header and footer methods. So I want you to think very carefully about an object that is meant to be printed, a page object, sort of like a web page. A lot of the web pages you see, they have headers and footers. They got copyrights at the bottom, menus at the top. They have common body text and an optional watermark. What I want is for you to stop the video and design a template method to do that. Okay, so design a template method that will represent this algorithm. Okay, so a Java method that will represent this algorithm. Okay, so I'm going to count down from 10. You can stop the video and then come back. So 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, and we're back. So you had the problem of executing this exercise as a template method. So we had a page to be printed. We wanted a customize for different header footers, common body text, and an optional watermark. An example implementation would have an abstract page class where the print method has print header, print body, print footer, print watermark. So, because header and footer must be provided, we keep them abstract. Since the page body is common, we implement it. And the watermark is not in really that special, and it's not as common as a header footer, so we leave it blank by default, empty. It does nothing. But it does get called. It is basically a hook. The draft page could be implemented in such a way. It could print header, it could keep the headers, it could keep the footers, but it could print a draft watermark all over the page. Okay? So, the template method, you write down an algorithm in the abstract, you take primitive operations, you mark them abstract, and you suggest that implementers implement those, fill them in, and extend your original template method algorithm. The idea is you're providing a framework where subclasses can specialize the behavior that you've already laid out in your template method. The next pattern we're going to cover is the factory method pattern. So consider this. We want to make a new pepperoni pizza. So we've got an algorithm, we're going to make a pepperoni pizza, then we're going to bake, cut, and box that pepperoni pizza. But not everyone wants a pepperoni pizza. And external actors are not necessarily going to interact with our code by providing us actual objects. Sometimes they'll provide serialized representations of what they want. For instance, they could provide us with the string pepperoni, and that could indicate they wanted a pepperoni pizza. Alternatively, they could provide us with the string veggie, implying that they want a veggie pizza. But what we're finding here is that a lot of the logic stays the same. Our logic to bake and cut and box the pizza will stay the same, but the initial type of the pizza differs, as well as the indicator of what the initial type of the pizza should be. Furthermore, when we bake and cut and box a pizza, we shouldn't care if it's a pepperoni pizza or a veggie pizza. All pizza's pizza, so we should be able to abstract up to a general group and operate on that. That is, we should operate on the abstractions and not the concrete classes. There's nothing in here that should really be all that veggie pizza specific, unless, say, we're actually building vegan pizza where the workspace might have to be configured differently to avoid any kind of contact with meat. So, here is our first attempt at writing code to bake, cut, box, and set up a pizza and return it. So here we've got make, we make a new pizza, sign up the pizza, bake, cut, box. So there's a problem here. We're basically using the superclass, but the superclass is abstract. It's not the actual pizza we really want. So how are we going to deal with this? How are we going to be able to specify the pizza? Well, we could use dependency injection, where the pizza is a parameter and it comes in. So this method, public pizza, order pizza, where we give pizza as a parameter, so you give a pizza in there, gives you a pizza out, it'll do the work, it'll bake it, cut it, box it, and return it. But we still need to instantiate that pizza. It doesn't help us. We still have this code where we still have to make that pizza. So what we could do is, instead of passing in that pizza, because that's not our input, we could allow the passing in of a string. And this string can indicate what kind of pizza we got. Also, there's a bug here. You remove pizza here and remove pizza here. So, if we pass in pepperoni, we build a new pepperoni pizza. If we pass in veggie, we build a veggie pizza, and then we work on it and we build it. We're basically constructing. We're making a kind of factory where we're building pizzas out of specifications. So this is our general pizza ordering method. What we'll find, though, is that this block of code, right, this code here will change. If we want to add another kind of pizza, we have to add it there. And it means that it manipulates this method, even though this part, the creation of the pizza, is basically a separate kind of role or responsibility from building the pizza here. So what can we do? How can we address this? One thing we can do is we can build a pizza factory. So here we've got a pizza factory, and it has a method called create pizza. And this create pizza has the responsibility that it can create pizzas. Okay, this is a bug too. These aren't supposed to be in the code. This makes a new scope. Anyways, this is one class whose sole responsibility is to generate pizzas from strings. That's a simple factory. So what we could do is we could simplify our order pizza method by getting the factory, building that factory, and then passing that string to that factory and getting a pizza built based on that specification, whether it's pepperoni or veggie, or even Hawaiian if we added Hawaiian. So all this effort, all this work, gets thrown into another class which has the sole responsibility of building pizzas. And that class is called Simple Pizza Factory. And that's a factory object. A factory object is an instantiation of this object, the Simple Pizza Factory, and it has a method that allows us to create pizzas. Because it is an object, you can have state in here. If there was some important information that the pizza should have been related to, or there was a bunch of initialization stuff that we had to deal with, we could put it here in the pizza factory, and then it would be inherited by the pizzas. When we build the pizza, we could provide that information to them. So, factory objects are not classes. It's not a static method. Factories objects are actual objects that we call, and we ask them to create other objects for us based on a specification. It simplifies our code quite a bit. The benefit of building a factory as a class and an object with actual methods, is that we can subclass it, and we can make, say, themed factories based on by inheriting our original factory. So, if we wanted to make a pizza store, right? Because if you look over here, we've got pizza store, and we've got a factory. What we could do is we can make a pizza store, and we give it a New York pizza factory, and then when we order a veggie pizza, we get a thin crust New York veggie pizza. Alternatively, we can make a Chicago pizza factory, and when we go to the Chicago store and order a veggie pizza, we'll get a deep dish veggie pizza done Chicago style, because that's the theme of the store. So we can change how the store operates, how it builds pizza, by providing a different factory inside. So it's a creational pattern. Another alternative to building a full-out factory and gaining the benefits of inheritance is, instead of building another class, we can build a method called a factory method. So this was called a factory. This is a factory method. We delegate to ourselves to create a pizza based on a string called pizza type. Then we might want to make specialized pizza stores, and we allow them to specialize by having their own implementation of create pizza based on a string. This allows us to keep the order pizza method general, and it protects us from specific pizza types, still allows us to build to inheritance, build to specification rather than implementation. This is the factory method. So I want you to consider why you might use a factory versus a factory method, or why you might use a factory method versus a factory. In this case, the pizza store is abstract. We still need to make implementations at the pizza store. So we have to make a New York style pizza store or a Chicago style pizza store, and they're going to create pizza. That's where they specialize. The factory method is meant to specialize the pizza being created. So our New York pizza store has a special special factory method called creates pizza, and it creates New York style pepperoni pizza and New York style plain veggie pizza. The Chicago style, will have Chicago style pepperoni pizza and Chicago veggie pizza. So if that pizza is very distinct, it might be important to have the create pizza be relevant in this method. So, the design intent of the factory method pattern is to define an interface for creating objects, but it lets the subclasses decide on which class to actually instantiate. So you have a general pattern that uses a general API, and then the subclasses specialize even the creation of objects. Because remember, constructors, they don't work that well in an inherited way. We don't have the same kind of virtual dispatch with constructors that we have with methods. By taking advantage of virtual dispatch in the subclasses, we can basically give constructors this virtual dispatch using the factory method. So here's the general structure of the factory method. We've got a creator class, like a factory or a pizza store or something. It's got a factory method. It has a useful operation. Inside of an operation, we make the product with the factory method. So we have a general idea of what the product is. So in our case, it was pizza. The concrete product, well, that will be like New York style veggie pizza or something like that. And it will be built by a concrete creator, such as New York style. Okay? So think about these. And now consider this exercise. You want to design a framework. You have application and document superclasses. An actual application would subclass these. So you'd have a My application that subclasses an application, and a My document that subclasses them. You cannot change the code of the superclasses. Okay? So you want to write a general new document method in application that ultimately instantiates a My document. But the My document is from document, and the My application is from application. So I want you to consider a factory method. Try to build a factory method that adheres to this pattern. Okay? So I'll count down from 10. I expect you to stop the video and work this out on your own, and then we'll go over a solution. So 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay, we're back. Now, I had asked you to use the factory method to have a structure where you had applications and documents, and you had my application, my document. So consider this. The application makes documents, right? So the documents aggregate application. Application has create and new document. New document is basically our operation. Inside of new document, we have document doc equals create document and docs.add doc, docs.open. Open document and create document and new document. So what we want to do is we want to inherit from this application and implement create document. So my application implements create document. And inside of it, it returns my new document. That's all the code it really needs. And my new document is simply a extension of document. All right? So that would be a solution. So we covered in this presentation, we covered factory method pattern. We covered factories, objects that make other objects. We also covered the template method and hooks. The template method had abstract methods that got implemented and were called inside of an algorithm, such as the coffee tea algorithm. So we covered all of those things in this talk. Thank you for your time.